Motion number 9 regarding housing for persons with disabilities. I call on Senator John Dolan to move the motion. You have 12 minutes, John.
Cathaoirleach, I move the motion. Minister, you're very welcome and I'm very pleased that you're here to participate in this motion. First thing I'd say to you, Minister, is that there were a number of motions that I could have put down in relation to disability, but I chose you. And people have said to me that other areas are more vital at this time. Unemployment is a massive issue. Health and social provision are massive issues. And also the area of income. And not to put a tooth in it, the issue of poverty for people with disabilities. So why put the focus on housing at this time? There is constant talk and mention from government in relation to what I would describe as the housing crisis. Underscored by references to a dedicated ministry for housing, your own department, the cross-party committee, the recent report, and all emphasise that this is the priority for government. Now, for the avoidance of doubt, and to be fully clear about this, the current, what I describe, recession rent housing crisis is an absolute crisis, and it requires urgent attention and action. I totally understand and support that, as do people with disabilities. I too see the children coming and going from hotels, and it is heartbreaking to see that, and it is something that has to be dealt with. I'm very happy to see that there are to state that there is very strong interest in this issue about disability housing. There are many people here from different disability backgrounds in the area of the deaf community, blind, mental health, neurological, physical, intellectual disability. It's a big issue right across the disability and mental health area. What I want to say is that what is totally unacceptable is the implicit acceptance that it's the only housing crisis in Ireland. Yes, we have this new housing crisis washing over us, and it's somehow the most attracting of necessary attention. What I'm here to do is to give voice, to garner support and action for the long-running housing crisis that we have in Ireland, a housing crisis that has deep roots in the culture of exclusion and lack of expectation. I'm here to give you, Minister, the opportunity to publicly set out what is being done to resolve this historic crisis in parallel with the other crisis that has to be dealt with as well. The current crisis that we have is based on the rightful notion that people have an obvious need for a house to live in, otherwise expressed as a right to housing. The journey begins in a very different place for people with disabilities. That place being institutional and separate settings. Ireland still has almost 3,000 people living in congregated settings. We have many others unnecessarily living in nursing homes. There's a deep-seated culture still that it is okay or acceptable that a disabled person would live in an institution without their consent and with others that they have not chosen to live with. It is well said that you can't choose the people you work with, but you can choose your friends. Well, for people with disabilities, many of them still don't have the assurance that they can get to choose those whom they live with or that their house will support them to live with ease and comfort with their loved ones. Let's turn to people trying to stay living in the community. And we are so often reminded that the policy is to keep people living and participating in the community. I think it's important not to forget that it has always been the determined will and resolve of people with disabilities themselves that have made the case, and always against the odds, to have their space in society, to win that space and to try and hold on to it. Not an easy thing over the last years that we've been through. They fought and struggled for every bit of inclusion, to drive a regular car, to attend a regular school, to go to the same workplace as others, to get on the same bus and train. In other words, just to be able to live independently. I want to go back to 1992 when the Disabled Persons Grant, that's 44 years ago, was first introduced. That too was fought for by people with disabilities. In 1980, NESC stated in Report 50, and I quote, The current grant is totally out of line with building costs. It should be reviewed annually or automatically linked to building costs. And it went on to say, the housing adaptation scheme, progressive as it was at the conception stage, has suffered from difficulties with implementation. It names three of these: differing interpretations, geographical location, many delays, not linked with the costs of adapting houses. And it concluded that an effective housing policy must involve three elements: a satisfactory adaptation scheme, provision within the building programme, and housing with support services where needed. So by that stage, and that's 30 years ago, there were shortcomings identified. And let's remember that this was a first and very strong effort at retrofitting, a scheme to ensure that people could stay living in the community. In 2004, NESC returned to that subject in its Housing in Ireland Performance and Policy Report number 112. And it quotes on the housing issues for people with disabilities from a Disability Federation of Ireland document, which stated that changes to the Disabled Persons Housing Grant, including the introduction of means testing and a reduction of individual amounts payable, have led to increased vulnerability for disabled persons, often at crisis points, including over long stays in hospitals and inadequate standards of housing, and that there were a limited range of housing options available. Now, 2004, we're in the height of the tiger, and it was being pointed out in a document by NESC that there were risks. In 2006, the NDA published a review of the disabled persons, and it said that it documents the variety of eligible criteria, eligibility assessment procedures and application processes which have developed across local authorities and which have created anomalies and inequalities in the provision of the grant. It set out other difficulties with the operation of the grant, things such as delays in occupational therapy assessments and inadequate grant levels. Now we're in 2016. It's sadly to be said that a scheme first introduced in 1972 is still underfunded and way underambitious, leaving so many people and families without access to the most basic of rights, a functioning and comfortable home. We have on an annual basis the routine closing down of the application process across our local authorities for the housing adaptation scheme. If we were in the work arena, it would now be enshrined as a custom and practice. That is what it has become. This is something that routinely happens every spring to summer. And so where the conversation commences for every new applicant is about, we have run out of money, come back again. How obscene, how wrongful is it to have people who were in dire and immediate need of something so basic to be presented with that routine notion and this idea that you have stop, start, implementation, administration and funding process? How is it okay to send people away every year? Every year, not once because there was a crisis or twice, but every year. It is the custom and practice of how this programme operates. I've met with many city and county councillors over the Seanad election campaign. And I have to say, and I'm very happy to say, I was so impressed with the commitment and resolve of so many of them in relation to the housing and other needs of people with disabilities. Yet they too are so frustrated that they cannot support people, their neighbours very often, to get necessary housing adaptations in a timely fashion, and that others cannot move into a house so that they can progress as adults and actually start to get on with their lives. Councillors spend so much time keeping faith with people in the slim hope that there would be a good result, but never a timely one. Also, so many family members and people across the disability and housing sectors put in so much time and effort. And in fairness, so too do public officials. But it's such a poor and frustrating use of time. The phrase, get on with your life, is certainly a cliche, but it is well packed with the essence of what a house can do for somebody. It's the keystone for the possibility of getting on with one's life, for having that opportunity to strike out as a person in your own right with whoever you wish to and love to live with. We all instinctively know this, yet almost 50 years from Ireland's first response to the housing needs of people with disabilities, we're nowhere clearer, nowhere near providing the housing response that is required. And to put it very directly to you, Minister, this is every bit as much a housing crisis as the awful current one, and it must have the same resolve and response brought to bear in solving it. This is the commitment, and this is the only commitment that is acceptable. And I know from people with disabilities that they're confounded by the notion that there might be just one housing crisis in Ireland, because that is all they hear about in the public space. All those waiting and needing home adaptations, the almost 4,000 waiting for social housing, and up to 3,000 still in institutions and their families and carers, can't accept that dominant notion, and I hope we can deal with that here this afternoon. That notion that there is only one housing crisis in Ireland for one group of people, and there is no doubt, and I say it again, that is totally unacceptable as well. More to the point, they see people with disabilities and their families see themselves as being airbrushed out of consideration. It's not too strong to say that they are being pushed aside as, if you like, the political oxygen only seems to permeate the recent crisis. This message is being picked up by people with disabilities and their organisations and groups as, we're used to waiting, so we can wait longer. Am I okay on time?
You're just going up to the end, right.
I'm getting there. Yeah. Okay. That waiting cannot go on any longer. There must be a strong start which people can see, resulting in new housing provision and stepped up output on the housing adaptations in the year ahead. This requires funding, and it requires it urgently. The programme for government states that the needs of people with disabilities will be incorporated in all future policies, that by 2021 it's acknowledged that there will be still 1,800 people in congregated settings, and at the same rate of dealing with the issue, it'll take another decade. These are not statements of resolve, statements to challenge. We need to see where the targets are. There are some in relation to congregated settings. There are processes, and I'm concluding now, Cathaoirleach, there are processes in fairness in place. There are processes in place. I've acknowledged them in the motion. So there is something very strong to build on. What's needed now is strong, definite targets and outcomes. And I am saying clearly that this issue needs to be solved over the next 3 years. Thank you.
Senator O'Sullivan to second the motion.
Lashka here, like I second the motion. I'm delighted for the opportunity to speak on this very important motion. And I urge all senators here to come on board and allow it to pass today. I thank my colleague, Senator Dolan, for bringing forward the motion, which is based on his considerable professional expertise. Regretfully, I was unable to speak earlier on the Seanad Bill, but I do want to briefly note that it's this kind of first-hand knowledge which the members of this House often bring to debate, and it is indispensable. It's an indispensable feature, and long may it continue on the road to Seanad reform. Senator Dolan has outlined very comprehensively the difficulties which persist for people with a disability in accessing the housing that they need. It's telling that at no point in our history, either through times of plenty or through times of austerity, has the state been able to guarantee that its citizens living with a disability will be as free to pursue living to their maximum potential as those who aren't. This is at its core an issue of equality. When we fully appreciate the lengths we still have to go to ensure that this equality can be guaranteed to all in terms of housing provision, then it becomes clear the kind of policy making needed from we need from government. We need forward thinking, not reactive, inclusive, not excluding, holistic, not piecemeal, consultative, not dictated. This is the standard by which we should seek to disability-proof our housing policy. This is the standard that the UN Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities challenges us to meet. Indeed, what better a metaphor than house building to describe how our policy should be? We need to get the design and construction right at the outset, then we'll end up with a durable structure capable of accommodating all. Unfortunately, we're far from the ideal scenario. While this motion seeks the kind of paradigm shift in thinking that we do need on disability, it also recommends some helpful measures that can be taken in the short to medium term that can go a long way to meeting the housing needs for those with disabilities. In particular, I would urge the government to take seriously the recommendations to ensure a reserved amount of Part 5 housing to be constructed to meet the needs of people with disabilities, the funding increase sought for adaptation grants and greater efficiencies in implementation. We must recognise that there are different levels of support required depending on the nature of a person's disability, and this must be reflected in the type of accommodation constructed or made available, that it's always fit for purpose. For the last three decades, charities and organisations devoted to assisting those with housing needs have often purchased low-quality homes which require significant retrofit in order to be made livable. Local authorities have been doing the same. This represents a very serious cost when you compare the cost of getting it right at the get-go, not only to charities and the state, but also to the residents who must live in poorly insulated homes. Many people living with a disability find themselves disproportionately in fuel poverty. So again, this represents an extra burden. We must get this right. When homes are being built at scale, we absolutely need to ensure that a certain percentage are built to standards for people with a disability. We also need to ensure that the resources are in place to be able to implement the recommendations of this motion. It's no good changing policy without the resources to back it up. We have ample evidence that the numbers of people in emergency accommodation in this state is increasing. What percentage of those people are with a disability? It should never be an emergency situation in the first place, and it's not fair that because of bad planning, mismanagement and a basic lack of sustained investment resources are swallowed up on meeting emergency demand. Take my own county, Waterford. There is a long, very long housing waiting list for accommodation suitable for people with a disability. I know this because I'm on the waiting list. My own daughter, who is 25, was born with physical and intellectual disability, and we've been on the list now for more than 5 years. I know my daughter's housing need will differ now from her housing need when she's 35, or even, and hopefully, 75. I know that, like many of her age, she will want to, in fact she wants to, live with her peers. At 35, she may well have a partner. At 75, she will have other needs. Fundamentally, as a mother, I want to be able to give her the ability to have a home environment that underpins her independence as much as possible and for as long as possible. For her housing to evolve and be life cycle in nature. This, I'm sure, is true for every other person in her situation. And again, this needs to be incorporated into our approach in delivering housing. This life cycle principle, as I hope it will be applied to my daughter, should be applied to how we plan for and build our communities. Because when we talk of building houses, really we are talking about building communities, and houses that are fit for purpose help to promote well-being. So, Minister, we need an integrated, inclusive and sustainable approach to building houses and homes for those less fortunate than you and I, those people with disability. And, Minister, I have full confidence in your ability to get this going. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator. Senator Paddy Coffey.
First of all, I want to commend both Senator Dolan and Senator O'Sullivan for proposing and seconding this motion, which is a very relevant motion in the context of the wider housing debate, which, as we all know, is one of the biggest challenges facing the country at the moment. And indeed, as a former local authority member myself for 8 years and a chairperson of a housing strategic policy committee within a local authority, I have had experience on the coalface where people with disability were presenting for housing. And, you know, in some cases, the local authority was able to respond, and others, unfortunately, as has been outlined by the senators, the local authorities, for one reason or another, whether it's down to resources or the actual building stock that's available, were not capable of responding in an appropriate fashion to meet the needs of the disabled persons involved. So this is something that I welcome bringing to the top of the agenda in terms of this motion. I know that Senator Dolan has long been an advocate for the disability sector, and he will continue now his advocacy here in the chamber. I want to congratulate him on that, and I offer him my support in whatever way I can in terms of progressing the interests of the disabled, especially now on the topic we are discussing in terms of housing. The housing need across the country, as I've said, it's one of the biggest challenges not facing the minister, but indeed society as well. And, you know, it's as no surprise, and without going over old ground again, you know, what has happened is we've experienced a huge collapse in the housing market. We've what we would call a dysfunctional property market, where, you know, we, in terms of local authorities, where they were denuded of resources for one reason or another, again, not pointing the finger, but that's a fact, where they weren't able to build houses or indeed adapt houses to the extent that they would have liked over the last number of years. So the challenge now is to rebuild that capacity within local authorities and indeed within the approved housing bodies sector as well, which I believe is a critical component in meeting the needs that are out there. And also, of course, to see the private sector, you know, going back to some levels of sustainability also. I do think when we're discussing and debating housing for the disabled, we should acknowledge some progress that has been made, and obviously there's always improvements to be achieved. But the Part M regulations are certainly a requirement now on all new building of properties, and indeed there's regulations also with rental properties that they are up to a standard that is appropriate for the accommodation of those that are disabled. And I think that should be acknowledged, and it's welcome that any new housing stock now, as we undertake new housing programmes in both the private and the public sector, must meet the Part M building regulations. The Part 5 elements were also mentioned, and I think it is important, and I know we're speaking to the Minister directly, who's the policy maker and who makes provision within the estimates for housing allocations. But ultimately, it's the local authority who is responsible for housing assessments in terms of eligibility and also for housing allocations. So there is a huge responsibility on local authorities, on the strategic policy committees that I just mentioned, on councillors themselves to make adequate provision to meet the demand in their own respective local authority areas. And I make one reference especially to the housing adaptation grants, which are available both private and indeed to public accommodate disabled persons. And if you look at a comparative basis across the country, some local authorities perform extremely well in drawing down funds from central government and from the minister's department, and some local authorities, quite frankly, are deplorable. You know, and that needs to be said as well, and I'm not pointing the finger at local authorities, but you know, if we look across the country, and I've had experience myself when I was Minister of State in the Department of Housing, where I've had deputies and senators from all parties wanting to know why their allocations weren't as high in the current year as possibly other years for housing adaptation grants. And the reasons, quite frankly, are that the local authority hasn't been as active in making provision of the 20% of funding, so that then they can draw down a greater 80% of funding from central government. So, you know, there's work to be done on local authority level as well to ensure that the strategic policy committees are, you know, approaching this topic in the same positive fashion as the senators have proposed. But there's also an onus on us, centrally and at national level, to ensure that we provide adequate resources for people with disabilities. Yes, we have a housing crisis. Yes, we have people living in unsatisfactory circumstances. But I think there is no doubt that all of us would agree that those with disabilities should be prioritised. It's not for the Minister to do that, as I said. It's for the local authority, who's the housing statutory body responsible for housing people. As I said, the approved housing bodies also have access to grant assistance to provide funding for disability. And, you know, the Department and the Minister, I'm sure, will outline through the social housing strategy, and I know he's working very much so on a new action plan for housing that we all look forward to hearing about. And I expect to hear provision within that action plan for housing to address some of the concerns that the senators have raised here today. I would also expect that the mobility grants, housing adaptation grants and other resources that are required to meet the need of the disabled people that so much need them will be provided for in the housing action plan. I mentioned the role of the local authorities. I think it would be remiss of us also to mention the cross-cutting that is required in other departments. And I include the HSE, who also have a role in terms of providing capital funds targeted at the acquisition and the refurbishment of properties to accommodate disabled individuals who are transitioning from priority institutions. So between the HSE and the Department of Housing and Local Government, which the Minister is now responsible for, I think there is opportunities there to enhance resources to help those that are disabled. I'm also conscious, Minister, that there are some anomalies in the system that might arise from time to time where, you know, an approved housing body may apply to the department for capital assistance funding, but they're literally falling between stools because of the HSE funding or the designated status of the centres. And I think that's something that possibly you and your officials should look at to ameliorate that anomaly in terms of creating a greater flexibility where people or approved housing bodies apply for funding, that they do qualify for disabled persons or people incapacitated in the same way as that local authorities or others would qualify for the capital acquisition schemes. Because that's the main bulk of funding that is available to local authorities and approved housing bodies. And I think just because a designation or a status applies to somebody, they shouldn't be excluded from that particular category. Some work will need to be done, I acknowledge, in terms of the HSE and ourselves in that respect. And, you know, I think there are enough mechanisms there, Minister, in the existing national housing strategy and indeed the national implementation framework to allow for those flexibilities to develop also. And I want to mention also that another anomaly that I've noticed where, especially in the South East, there's quite a number of housing institutions for the elderly. They're registered as approved housing bodies, but they're being regulated as nursing homes. Now, they're not, in fact, nursing homes, and they're coming under the same regulation from HICWA and all the rest of it. These are older people that live independently in these organisations with sheltered support, essentially. And you are taking people off the housing list in those relevant local authorities, meaning that local authorities or approved housing bodies won't have to provide funding for these elderly people. But unfortunately, again, because of their status, they're falling between stools. And if some of these come under pressure due to HICWA rules and can't secure investment from the various government grants, well, they will close and you will be without further supports for elderly people and indeed disabled people as well. So I'll conclude now. I'll ask Cathaoirleach to say I welcome this motion. I welcome the opportunity for all of us to make our contributions, and there's also an opportunity for the Minister and his officials to review the current supports that are there and enhance them where possible in the future estimates and the forthcoming action plan for housing. Go ahead, Margaret,
thank you, Senator. Senator Jennifer Murnane O'Connor.
Cathaoirleach, Minister. Fianna Fáil is happy to support this motion. Minister, we need to ensure that people with disabilities are given equal opportunities and access to essential services. 13% of our population is classified as having a disability. I hope that the new National Disability Inclusion Strategy, which is due to be in place by the end of the year, will reflect this vision. And I think that's crucial, Minister. Also, I want to welcome the establishment of the Housing and Disability Steering Groups within all local authorities that has just been set up. Now, I did have queries about that, but it's only after being, I believe, set up, because I always felt the disability sector was never addressed enough. So I know this new steering group now has only been set up, but at least it's set up, and Minister, I know you will address it. In 2011, the HSE published the report Time to Move On from Congregated Settings, which is a residential facility with 10 or more people for residential support, into mainstream community. Now, this is crucial. This is crucial in the fact that on the agenda today, and I'm sure you'll see it, Article 19A of the United Nations Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disability, which states that persons with disabilities have the opportunity to choose their place of residence and where they and whom they live with on equal basis with others, and not obliged to live in a particular living arrangement. And I think this is crucial. I think people with disability are very vulnerable in our society, and I always believe they're forgotten. From my experience with local authorities, like yourself, I was 19 years on the local authority, and the only scheme of funding for people with disabilities was the CAS, which is the Capital Assistance Scheme. And this is for people with disability, elderly and the homeless. Now, if I wanted to apply, like all local authorities, say Carroll local authorities will apply to the government, to the department for a houses, say they have 10 people with disabilities, they might only get the funding for 3. So there's always a backlog with people with disabilities, and this needs to be addressed. I believe, Minister, that there should be a capital funding for people with disabilities separate. I firmly believe you need to address this in your programme for government. There's also, there's two schemes, there's two grants for people. We have the Mobility Aids Grant, which, as you're all aware of, is the local authority one, but that only goes up to €6,000, which only means that only small works can be done, like handrails, or maybe if you want to take out a bath to put in a shower. But there's also, I know, the housing adaptation for people with disabilities, which is up to €30,000, but that's means tested. And where you have a family that have disabilities, or maybe have one or two children with disabilities, they have to come up with more of the funding. So I'm asking you, Minister, to look at this housing adaptation for people with disabilities, and also the one for the mobility aids. It is important that as the economy recovers, that people with disability are not left behind. Disability inclusion must be a central tenet of this government's agenda, and access to services and resources must be directed in the first instance to those most in need, and in particular to the people with disabilities. I always felt as a councillor, and now I'm here in the Senate, that lack of information was the biggest issue to do with people with disabilities. I always felt they were forgotten. So I'm asking you, Minister, when you're putting this new programme in place, that you make sure that people with disabilities knows their entitlement. And it's something that I believe needs to be addressed seriously. So in your new action plan, Minister, I hope you might have some word on this today, because as you're aware, we have emergency housing crisis. There's homelessness, as you've even seen today, children in B&Bs, people trying to get back to school, cutting on foods because they can't afford to get their children back to school. So I'm asking you, Minister, to come back with us urgently with this new housing action plan, because I believe that we need to address it. Thank you.
Thank you. Senator Boyan.
Minister, I'd like to welcome you to the House. I'd also like to thank the Senators, Senator John Dolan, Grace O'Sullivan, Francis Black, Alice Mary Higgins, Colette Kelleher and Lynn Rowan, for using this private member's time to bring this very, very important issue to the floor of the Seanad. I am a former director of the Irish Guide Dogs for the Blind, having spent many years on its board, and therefore I'm pretty involved and have continued to remain involved in the whole issue of the disability sector. We had a catchphrase, small slogan down in Cork for the Irish Guide Dogs for the Blind. I'm sure, Minister, you'd be very familiar with their organisation coming from your neck of the woods. And it was simple. We tried to encapsulate what's our core message, what's our ethos, what's our work. And it was about providing independent mobility with dignity. And it just reminded me, when I've reflected on that, what is this all about? This is about people's rights, enshrined in the European Convention on People with Disabilities. They have special rights. It is about choice. It is about dignity and being allowed to play a meaningful, independent, where possible, role within people's communities, where they decide. I acknowledge Minister Coveney's work in this whole area as a former minister, junior minister in your department, and in fairness, he did an awful lot on it. And I know he mentioned here in the previous contribution to the Seanad, he's done it again today, about local authorities. I have been a member of a local authority for many years. Yes, local authorities have failed, but what has successive ministers done? We can't talk about some divorced issue about, you know, Dáil Éire and Seanad Éire and local councils. These councils are made up with members of your party, Fianna Fáil, all parties and none. And I know what's happened or hasn't happened in some cases in the Strategic Policy Committee of Planning, in the Strategic Policy Committees of Housing. There is no joint up thinking. There is no commitment. There is no drive. I don't need to tell you, Minister, the lack of enthusiasm by some local authorities in delivering houses. Dunleary Rat Down, the council I come from, 6,500 people on the housing list. Loads and loads of excuses. Loads of people looking into it. Loads of councillors from all groups and none bringing proposals, and chief executives who are hugely empowered by legislation and by the political process stand up and say it's about resources. I'm fed up with these excuses for resources, and I'm fed up with politicians saying it's part of the establishment or part of the county managers or chief executives. We've got to pull it all back. I'd nearly be saying that we need a major housing body for Dublin City and County. The local authorities have not delivered on housing. That's the reality, Minister. You know your sums. You're preparing a major report on housing. And I've talked to a number of the county managers, chief executives, and they're somewhat, they're interested to hear what you're coming up with. But let's acknowledge that local authorities have not delivered. And you could go on to say that local elected members have not pushed the matter themselves and address the issue. And I've been a strategic policy committee since have a quorum. 10 minutes later, they're all emptied out of the room. So they're facts, and I don't want to keep going on about that. I think the key message is, Minister, and I hope with your report that you're going to bring out, is that we set aside quotas for the delivery of houses for people with disabilities. We also provide resources, or tell local authorities to provide resources. We stop, now the legislation is in place, which is great. We were taking money in lieu of Part 5s for years. That's changed. Okay, that's changed on board. Not anymore, I accept it, but we took a hell of a long time, but the political establishment took a hell of a long time to cob onto it. And there are substantial monies held in Part 5 accounts. Can I give you one challenge and only one minute? I'm going to sit down. I want you to request from every chief executive of every local authority in this country in the next week what monies they are holding on deposit from Part 5s. And I want you to instruct them tomorrow not to spend a penny of it till they come back to you. And I want to find out all the money that's either due to the local authorities or bonds that are due to local authorities or Part 5 funds. There's a kitty for you. And I think if you had any sense, you would ring-fence that money and get on the blower tomorrow and say, look, lads, that's going to be part of my strategy. That's the only challenge I'm leaving you. I think you will be pleasantly surprised if you haven't already done it yourself. I know you're a very capable minister. You're more likely on to this. But let's look at the Part 5s, let's look at the money that's been gathered up from developers in lieu of Part 5s, and see if we can ring-fence the current funds for fast-tracking some housing in relation to the disability. But set targets and demand reports month in, month out. You're the Minister, the buck stops with you. There's great expectation and excitement about you in local government. You're a man that has delivered in the past in agriculture. You're a man that's committed. You're a man who's of your word. I think across the political spectrum, they acknowledge that about you. The task is up to you. It's a big one, but you can deliver, and you can deliver for the people that really matter.
Cromagut, Senator O'Donnell.
How much time do I have?
8 minutes.
Yeah, you might have a minute remaining. I want to commend John Dolan for bringing this forward. I know John of old from his role with disabilities, and it's something I have a particular interest in, and it's something I think that we can all collectively agree on. I suppose there are a number of aspects to it. I suppose just looking at the whole disabilities area and looking at, and I suppose I can only speak the context of, I suppose, firsthand from my own constituency of Limerick, where we have the main providers, the Daughters of Charity in St Vincent's, Lisnagroy, Bonmore and St Joseph's Foundation in Charleville, providing really for disability services, along with others like Enable Ireland. I'm talking about really where there you have the residential settings in terms of housing. They do fantastic work. I suppose a couple of points that are coming forward. The congregated settings, I think the key issue really is it's a positive measure to have people with disabilities living in their communities. It's very natural. It requires that bit more work than normal housing, and I think resources have to be put into it. more recently, and when Senator Coffey was Minister for Housing, he provided funding for Cappamore Voluntary Housing Association to build up to 12 units with disabilities people being accommodated. That's very progressive, that's very positive, that's gone back into a village rural setting, and it's something I want to commend him on and to thank him for. People at Cappamore are very delighted, and I think it's a positive measure. One thing that struck me, Minister, reading down through the issue was the whole issue of the reporting by local authorities of the number of units for people with disabilities on an annual basis. And I was struck by the fact that it's public funds, and yet there doesn't appear to be any reporting structure outside the local authority members themselves. And yet that has to be changed. I assumed that reporting structure was there. I find it isn't. I think it's something in your action plan for jobs, it's action plan for housing, that should be an automatic. And I think what you would get from that is you would be able to compare local authorities. There are probably some local authorities doing fantastic work. There are some local authorities maybe not doing as well. And I think you have to benchmark if it involves public funds. Obviously, following on from that, and Senator Boyle made reference to it, the issue of the Part 5 funding, unspent Part 5 funding. I think a large chunk of that should probably go towards the area of disabilities. And disabilities has a broad spectrum. And I think what you're looking at is, and I've seen it from, I can just think of examples off the top of my head, elderly parents looking after a severely disabled son, that son attending one of the main service providers in Limerick City. He lives with them on a daily basis. They are now in their 70s. Luckily, there's a very, very person involved in that area within the Midwestern health area, and he is looking to provide accommodation for them long term. And one of the greatest worries for parents for children with disabilities is when they pass on themselves. And it's one of the imponderables, and John will know this, it's never really been satisfactorily. We have to find a mechanism whereby, and it's, you have the likes of St. Joseph's providing residential settings, you have the likes of Barnmore, Lisnagry, St. Vincent's and Lisnagry Daughters Charity as well. It's something we need to look at in terms of disabilities. It's not easy in that you're looking at the type of properties that are suitable for people with disabilities. Invariably are bungalow settings. Invariably are have to be on ground floor. Invariably they have to be adapted. I think it's extremely important that we find ways that people can live within their own areas. So if you have a son or a daughter who's disabled living with parents, we have to find a mechanism that they maybe can get a unit living quite near their parents. These are human dimensions for people with disabilities that are extremely important. And I think that this is a very much, this particular private members I wholeheartedly support. It's opportune, Minister, that you're bringing this action plan for housing forward. I think these are all matters that can be integrated. So for me, the positives are the funding, the 10 million under the CAS system, that's the funding went to Cappamore, Voluntary Community Housing, towards former Minister Paddy Coffey. The movement out of congregate settings, hugely important. The 20 million that's been provided to adapt buildings specifically. The Disabled Persons Grant is a good grant, but it's limited. And we've all availed of it as both councillors and TDs and senators over many years for constituents. But I think what we have to look at here is that we have to bring the issue of dealing with people with disabilities mainstream. It's getting to that point. We have to ensure that people can live in their own communities. We have to ensure that houses are adapted. I very much welcome that you've set up specific groups within local authorities. But I think probably the dots are all there within the local authorities themselves. But I think the dots need to be joined up where local authorities are benchmarked. It involves serious public funds. I think what should be looking at there is that when the report is produced to the members, which they are duly entitled to as local authorities, that same report goes to the department and goes to you as Minister for Housing. I think that would bring a certain cohesion on funding. But when we get down to it, we're dealing here with human lives, funding part fives, which should be integrated as part of the annual reporting mechanism as well. And I very much welcome, I think your action plan for housing is coming out next week, am I correct? Tuesday. And I very much welcome that. I've no doubt that there will be a section dealing with disabilities. But what I really would like to see is disabilities that specific funding is provided, but the area of disabilities is basically mainstreamed into the normal society housing, and that if someone will say living in a village or in a rural or urban setting, what I wouldn't like to see, and I've seen it on occasions, where people are moved from their own home environments somewhere away to a unit that's ideally suitable for them in terms of physical structure, but doesn't need their emotional and human needs as well, and that's extremely important. Thank you.
Thank you. Senator O'Cluckery.
You're very welcome again. You're here quite a lot recently. Just on an aside, the issue of the bins hasn't gone away. I have corresponded with you again. There are still outstanding issues there that need to be resolved, but we'll deal with that another day. Gaidol Shees, Curran Falta, Harkon, Group Sinn Féin, Riven Runcha, the Shafir Hawatoch, Taldini Lemi Humus, Erin Group, Vihis, Lesh Kamor, Mariola, and the Kiriha, Exola, Kuru Vaim, Lelin, Nadena. Tafurala Hamaha, and Sarunsha, Echen Ladini, will me Humus Arabacher in the Goni, a mask and fubble, Agus Naharia, Esgoyena, Erhikiatayena, Hulogus Fader. We in Sinn Féin welcome this comprehensive motion, and I'm happy to see that there seems to be broad consensus on the motion across the House, especially given that people with disabilities were disproportionately affected by savage cutbacks during the austerity period. It was clear from the various U-turns that the last government carried out that they really did not fundamentally understand the real-life impact of cutbacks or withdrawal of services for those with disabilities. The motion seeks to accelerate the move from congregated settings to living in the community. Previously, we in Sinn Féin have supported such moves, but would also like to seek assurances that full integration takes place as well. Therefore, I welcome the measures in the motion that call for disability proofing of the Social Housing 2020 strategy. I especially welcome the provision for a percentage of Part 5 housing to be set aside for those with a disability, and I would concur with Senator Boyan as well on the comments he has made about the funding. I think full clarity as to where the Part 5 funding is, where it has been and how much there is, certainly would be very, very welcome, and perhaps you could come back to the House or circulate those figures when they are made available to you. Under Fianna Fáil and the Fine Gael Coalition from 2010 to 2014, the Housing Adaptation Grant was cut by a staggering 56%. This cut has had a detrimental effect on the amount of units available that are suitably adapted. It also meant that many people with disabilities who wished to remain at home were forced to live in accommodation that was wholly unsuitable. I visited a man in my own home area recently. He's in a wheelchair, he lost a leg. He has no social housing that is adapted available to him, so he's renting a chalet basically from a local person. And when I went in to see his situation, it was absolutely unbelievable that he's in a wheelchair, and the corridor that he has to traverse every day and night is literally just enough for him to get in and out with a wheelchair. All the shelves are too high, and cupboards, etc. So he's in a really difficult situation. And he was at his wit's end, and he was actually getting very depressed because of the whole situation and the fact that he's been on the housing list for quite a number of years and is absolutely getting nowhere with the local authority on that. So this is really, it's a very much a personal issue for so many people, and that's only one example. Again, this is part of the hidden side of the cuts that many previous governments were blind to or didn't want to know about. These people are languishing on the list. Everybody on the housing list is certainly unhappy that they're so long on the list, but people with a disability, I think, are being given an added burden to carry. The housing adaptation grant for people with disabilities should be made available to tenants of local authorities and should be paid to voluntary housing agencies and indeed private landlords to encourage people to make the necessary adaptations of the housing stock, such as the ones I've outlined. There was a recent report in the Connacht Tribune as well that residents of council houses in Galway had to wait up to 18 months for vital extensions only to be turned down. According to the report, the council didn't carry out a single extension last year. It's disgraceful to make people wait this long, even just to find out what is going to happen in what are already obviously unsuitable units. It's also short-sighted, as the population with disabilities and the over 65 population is increasing rapidly. There are very sensible provisions in the motion that take account of the existing housing crisis, and if there are to be any major moves towards significant new house builds, that these plans must contain provisions for those with disabilities. So, while I'm aware that the group of Ram Forster Thieves has been running for 14 years, holding Kerry as a sole And I do welcome, Minister, that you are coming forward with your own plan next week. I know that the committee, which my colleague Owen O'Brien was a member of, worked very, very hard on a lot of the recommendations that they have made as well in the whole area. And I do appreciate that you recognise that this is an absolute emergency, really, at this stage in the whole housing sector. But certainly, we don't want people with disabilities to be the poor relations again in relation to housing. They need to be central to all of the policy, and all of the policy that is coming forward should be disability proofed, in my opinion. So Leshin Buan Rog will mutako Leshirunagus Tasulangame Bart to rare breher Nura Hukus Shah Guti on Tariga the Haha.
Senator McFadden.
I commend Senator Dolan and the group for bringing forward this PMB. I welcome the Minister's intention to proceed with the implementation of a vision for change, and in particular the report of the Working Group on Congregated Settings, which was a far-reaching indictment of the residential care settings for people with intellectual disabilities. We have had to wait 9 years for the implementation of the vision for change, and 5 years for any progress on the report on the congregated settings. In the meantime, last year we saw a prime-time investigation into Áras Attracta, which uncovered the appalling service many people with intellectual disabilities continue to receive at the hands of the state. And I am ashamed to say that in 2016, when almost all of the large residential centres in the United Kingdom have closed, nearly 50% of Irish citizens who receive residential services still live in outdated institutional settings. In many cases, the lives of these people that they lead are more impoverished than those who receive no services at all. This is a real housing crisis for people with intellectual disabilities. For any building to become a home, it must be imbued with a range of meanings, feelings and experiences by its occupants. A home is not merely a shelter. A real home has heart, a sense of warmth and comfort. A real home has heart. It is a place of emotional warmth and emotional connection. A home is a place of privacy where the occupant can control who can come in and who cannot come in. A real home has a sense of identity. It has roots. It is where the person belongs. If we accept all of these as definitions of a home, then most people who live in a congregated setting are actually homeless. They may have shelter, but without heart or heart, privacy or identity, a house is not a home. Minister, I implore you, people with intellectual disabilities do not need bricks and mortar. They do not need politicians and planners to develop housing and then consign them with beds. This is putting the cart before the horse. No one should be consigned a house without first being allowed to articulate a vision for a better future. In this way, housing, like all aspects of the lives of people with disabilities, must be an interdepartmental concern, with the voice of people with disabilities at the centre. Because services for people with disabilities should not be service-centred, staff-centred or building-centred. Disempowerment has been the history of people with disabilities. Let it not be their future.
Senator Oriel Dodd.
Thanks very much, Eckhart Herrig. And just firstly to thank the senators for putting down this motion, which the Labour Party obviously is delighted to support. And it's really interesting debate, I have to. I'm sure the Minister will agree. The expertise that's in this room is quite remarkable, from the campaigning sector to obviously parents Senator O'Sullivan's contribution was quite impressive. Obviously, former local authority members and indeed a former Minister for Housing in the Seanad as well, it adds a great weight to the debate. I suppose in general terms I want to say, like all issues when dealing with people with disabilities, unfortunately we tend to compartmentalise out these issues, and I know this from my experience as Minister of State in the last government when dealing with the employment issue, that the tendency was to view issues of people with disabilities as separate from the mainstream. And I think that's a mistake because employment is important, housing is important, regardless of how crises come and go. And I think there's a tendency in Irish public policy is that, well, let's sort out the main stream crisis or emergency first, and then we can deal with these supposed or can be characterised as side issues, but they're central to the entire debate. And it was a disappointment for me, and I know people in the sector, when we were looking at the action plan for jobs, it didn't include a more comprehensive set of proposals for every sector of society. And as Senator McFadden has quite rightly said, this does come down to issues of empowerment and identity. And what's more important to your identity than what job you do, and what's more important to your identity than where you live. And it's central to our view of getting away from the charitable view of people with disabilities to a more rights-focused and rights-centred approach to this entire area. So what I would suggest to you, Minister, and I know you're grappling with this issue as a new person in the job, I know you're intending and publishing your action plan for housing next week, but even at this late stage, I might implore on you that within that action plan for housing, there is a section dedicated to housing for people with disabilities, because we have had a litany of failures. And I think, this goes beyond, governmental records going back, has been previously mentioned, because people have mentioned what local authorities have done and don't do. And I'll give two points, if I might, in terms of local authorities' response. And Senator Boylan mentioned local authority members. And I think it's legitimate to say that it's not good enough for local authority members to complain about lack of resources coming from central government when they are beating down the door in order to reduce the property tax in their own local area by 15%, which would be a perfectly adequate funding mechanism to supply housing for various different sectors of society that need it. And then, to vote down that by 15%, as is their power, and then to complain about lack of resources. And I think, if we're going to be serious about the services that we want our local councillors to supply in their own local authority areas, then they have to take the responsibility seriously and deliver for those that need it most. I would secondly say that there needs to be an understanding in the wider society about the necessity for housing, because when it comes to housing for people on the edges of society, and this can include traveller accommodation, it can include issues for people with addiction issues, it can include issues for people with mental health problems and people with disabilities. You will always get, or regularly get, a kickback from residents, and residents' groups and communities. And I've been, and I'm quite sure everybody in this room who's involved in politics has been, to meetings where things are said that I think in the fullness of time people might be embarrassed by. So while everybody wants solutions to the homelessness crisis, everybody in society wants homelessness to be resolved, but not necessarily on their doorstep. And everybody feels that there should be traveller appropriate accommodation, but nowhere near them, thanks very much. And everybody feels that we should have proper accommodation for people with disabilities or with mental health challenges or whatever, but not near me. And after the election, Minister, I was at a public meeting in my own constituency related to a 68-unit development. And I felt I was at a pitchfork meeting from somewhere in the deep south, Alabama, 1950s. Some of the things that were said in that room. One woman stood up and said she'd never been ashamed to live in the community in which she lives until she sat in that room that night. 250 people in the room, packed, upset about the suggestion that there would be 68 social housing units in their community. And you compare that with the public outcry over homelessness and housing crisis, and compare that with the rhetoric that comes from local authority members, yet they vote down the local property tax by 15%. So there's a collective responsibility, of course, all sectors, politics and those with responsible leadership positions in their own communities, to be part of the solution here as well. I wish you every success, Minister. You know, none of us in this chamber, I believe, and certainly not my own party, don't intend in any way to be obstructionist or to score political points on an issue like this. There are practical solutions that can be found. You know, issues for the elderly have been suggested. I met with a group recently who are talking about the dead space issue in more senior citizen concentrated areas of Dublin, for example, where you may have one person living in a four-bedroom house, and how we can, you know, proactively use the local authority to potentially renovate the upper portion of that house to facilitate a rental income for that person, who could then readapt the lower section of the house to ensure that that dead space upstairs finds a funding mechanism to, you know, to refurbish, if you like, the lower space in the house. So we don't have this idea that you're a single person in your older years in a four-bedroom house. We must find a smaller unit for yourself. People have their own, you know, their neighbours and their contacts around them. But there's inventive ways that the different groups are coming together to try and find solutions to the problems that we face. So, Minister, just to conclude and just to summarise, the expertise in this room is quite remarkable. I think the motion is... Many motions that come in front of this House and other Houses can sometimes be provocative for the sake of being provocative. I think this is a comprehensive, well thought out and detailed motion, which I think will benefit you. I think the message has to go out to local authorities to do the job that they're to do, but also the local authority members to take the responsibility of the budgets that they pass seriously. The societal responsibility to take on, you know, this issue across society, as I said. But essentially, the central point I might say, Minister, is that please not to make the mistake of the action plan for jobs and divorce the employment issue for people with disabilities away from the central action plan for jobs employment strategy. If you have a housing strategy coming out next Tuesday, not to divorce housing needs for people with disabilities separate from your central document. I know it's a document that's done in the middle of an emergency. I can completely understand that on Tuesday there'll be people lining up to take pot shots at and to criticise it before it's even been published. But at the same time, even at this late stage, with the guts of a week to go, perhaps if it hasn't been done, and I've no knowledge whether it has or hasn't been done, that within that strategy you can contain many of the, if not all, of the suggestions that have been placed in this motion. But, Minister, I wish you every success, and the Labour Party are here to assist in tackling the issues that you have to tackle.
Thank you, Senator. Senator Davitt.
Seanad, congratulations on your new post. Just I'm going to keep it quite simple. I know John over the years, I know of him and all the great work he has done for people with disabilities over the years. And indeed, I often hear people in my own locality still talk about John fondly and all the work he has done. So I'm certainly delighted here with Jennifer here to support your motion here today, John. I suppose people with disabilities should really be prioritised in any housing policy. Council SPCs, I suppose, have a certain, liability that they have to shoulder and weight that they have to carry in relation to this particular criteria. And really, they should try harder to facilitate people with disabilities. They should be a priority. There's no doubt about that. The upgrades that have changed in the planning regulations over the year have made housing, that have brought them on stream, and there has evidently been costs associated with that: door widths, room sizes, level of lights, all the different things that have been associated with disability, and there have been huge steps forward, but there has been a cost associated. I'm just curious, Minister, it's a proposal I actually made with the IPAV, the Auctioneering Institute, in relation to VAT and housing. And this possibly, on a small front, might be, it could be a step forward. Possibly if a builder or developer was talking to a council and they were to look at a project and it had came from your own office, maybe Minister, that housing in relation to disability would be VAT-free, I think it would be a massive step forward. It would give you a chance maybe to trial it on a small scale. And the calculations we did at the time were there would be a saving of about 19%. Now, I know 13.5% is the broad rate for a builder to claim, but the cost of the goods themselves and also the levies, if the council didn't include the levy charge as well, we reckon there could be a saving of just under 20%, 18 to 20% is what we costed that. So I think this would be a very good area to start. I think it would be make it practical. I think guys that are at that the cost of build, we're not at it yet in most counties anyway, maybe in Dublin we are, but most regional counties we're not at the cost of build yet, so nobody is looking at these projects. You have lots of guys sitting on sites, but if they're able to come talk to the council, say look at, okay, I can build my house for 18 to 20% less, it's going to make it attractive, and the council could say, you know, we could look at now, we have 50 people that we need urgent housing for that have disabilities, and this could certainly answer that problem. I think it would be a massive step forward. I think it would be cost neutral, Minister, and it might just be a model that if it worked, and I know you are very resourceful and you have been doing a lot of work and you've taken submissions from several bodies, as I'm aware, and I do appreciate the hard job you were left in. No more than Paddy, it wasn't an easy job heretofore either, but it just could be something maybe you could look at, maybe afresh, and it might give us the answer we want, Minister. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Bourke. Senator Colin Bourke.
Thank you, Cathaoirleach. Look, welcome, Minister, and wishing you well in the development of the new document in relation to housing. I just want to touch on a lot of the areas that I wanted to speak on have been touched on. First of all, to thank the Senators, for Senator Dolan, Senator Sullivan and the Independent Senators for bringing forward this this motion. I think it's very welcome and I think it's very timely. As someone who's a member of a local authority and as someone who was involved in a number of issues over the last 2 to 3 years in relation to disabilities, I found it extremely frustrating, as did a lot of families who were dealing with the local authorities, about the way particular local authorities had managed their looking for assistance in relation to adaption work to be done to local authority houses. And in particular, there was one particular case, and in fact there were a number of cases, but there were two particular cases which I was forced to take to the Ombudsman and assist the families in order to get action and work done in relation to houses. One family, they had received a letter from the local authority in July 2008 confirming that they were on the list for adaption work. They had a child with severe intellectual and physical disability. They had the full support of the public health nurse and with the full support of the organisation who was assisting them in relation to the care of their child. And to find, I came across them 6 years later, 6 years after they were told they were on the list for adaption work to take place. 6 years later, no work was done. And for 8 months, I corresponded with a local authority and still nothing done. And as a result, it ended up going to the Ombudsman before any work was done. I'm glad to report that the necessary work was done in the house to make it that much easier for the family to look after that child. But I think it was outrageous that it took a total of 7.5 years from the time of the application going in to the time work being done, yet they had the full support and there was clear evidence that this family were doing a way beyond the call of duty, in the sense that if this child was in full-time care of the state, it would be costing us about 2,500 to 3,000 a week to look to provide the level of care that the parents were providing for their child, and yet they had to fight 7.5 years before there was work done. But the question I want to ask, and this is the issue, is about access officers in local authorities. As I understand it, there is supposed to be an access officer in each local authority, and local authorities around the country have totally different definitions as to what the role of the access officer is. Now, my understanding from the legislation is that the access officer is to look at not only about access for people with disabilities to public buildings, but about access to all local authority services. For instance, I put in a question to a number of different local authorities, and one local authority gave me the information that the access officer had been involved in two projects for the entire 12 months, costing a total of €4,000. And that's what they did for the entire. Now, I'm not saying that the access officer wasn't doing other work, but that was their sole contribution to access for people with disabilities in the 12-month time period. And I'm saying, and I was on to the Disability Authority about it as regards, you know, what is their role? We put in legislation, what is their role? And particularly it applies in relation to people with disabilities, making sure that there's someone there within the local authority to fight their corner. And I think it's something, Minister, that your department should now look at. And if the legislation isn't adequate to make sure that there isn't, that the role of the access officer is not clearly defined, because I think it should be clearly defined that there should be someone in there who's prepared to put forward the best possible case for the person with the disability. And I think it's something that we urgently need to do. I just think, you know, we have made a lot of progress over the last number of years, but there are still a lot of areas where we tend to park them and say, you know, it's something we'll get around to. I think we have a great opportunity now that I suppose that there is, better funding being provided to local authorities, but it's also about coordination both at national level and at local level, and making sure that the local authorities, which are not following through on their role, are brought to heel. And that was the one issue that I found in relation to dealing with this whole issue of adaption grants, about where some local authorities had their plan of action done as far back as November or December before the following year as to what they, what work they needed to do in relation to adaption work in local authority houses, whereas other local authorities were waiting until the department said, well, there will be some money this year for adaption work, and please let us have your submission. And then the submission was taking another 3 to 4 months before it arrived in your department. And I think that's something that needs to be looked at as well. I think we need to clearly set out to local authorities that over the next 3 to 4 years, this is a kind of a guideline as regards what funding will be made available for adaption work, so we can do clear long-term planning over that 3 to 4 years. Because I think this problem that local authorities will use as the excuse, well, we can't get adaption work done because we don't know how much funding we're getting. And then some local authorities are saying, we're getting the funding for the adaption work in June or July, and we're not able to use it by the end of December, therefore we have to refund the money to the department. I think we should stop, we should make sure that there aren't any excuses there for local authorities to be refunding money, and I think that's extremely important in relation to this whole area. I think everyone who's made a contribution here has made a very good contribution in relation to the different areas. And I think a very valid point that was made in relation to Part 5, making sure that money that's there, which is supposed to do, which was supposed to be provided in relation to infrastructure work, to make sure that it's not left there for another 3 to 4 years when we could use it, and we could use it urgently in relation to a lot of local authority houses. Finally, could I just touch on one area in relation to, and one other senator has raised it, and that's in relation to houses where, and as recently as this weekend, and doing clinics this weekend, where people are living in 4-bedroomed houses on their own and they want to downsize, and they're on the housing list with a local authority with 5 or 6 years to downsize, and local authority are not responding, where they're quite prepared to take a 2-bedroomed, a smaller house and free up a 4-bedroomed house. And I have a number of people in my own local authority area where that's the position. And I think it's about making sure that local authorities are given, they have the power, but they seem to be very slow to react to respond to that change, where a 3- and 4-bedroom house could be immediately made available for a family. I know it's slightly moving away from the point of this debate, but I do welcome the debate, and I think it's important that we now set out and identify the areas where work wasn't being done, making sure that the funding that is available is used in a timely manner so that the necessary work can be carried out. Thank you.
Senator Crockwell.
I want to thank Senator Dolan and Senator O'Sullivan for bringing this important motion to the House. Minister, you took over your president portfolio, and I congratulate you on that. And you took it over, I would say, with great enthusiasm, and I sincerely hope that the expectations that people are building around you are not overly complicated, if you want. I believe you will do everything you can in the area of housing crisis, but you're not God. You can only do so much. And I hope that we understand that as you deliver your programme. Senator Dolan, in his presentation, mentioned the line, get on with your life. And it's on that basis I want to speak to you, not about disability, but about ability. I'm personally aware of two young men, both profoundly disabled, both married, both living within the city centre area, both paying massive rent. And they live in a constant state of fear of homelessness because they're about at the limit of what they can afford in rent. They will never, ever, ever be able to save a deposit for a house. It's just not possible in the current environment they live in. Moreover, if they go to buy a house or to buy an apartment, it cannot be in the suburbs. It has to be in the city centre because they work in the city centre, and for that they will pay a premium. More importantly, if they do ever find a way of finding or the money to purchase an apartment in the city centre, they are going to have it completely and utterly renovated. One of the individuals I'm talking about loves to cook. He is an absolute fantastic cook. But everything must be at ground level. Because this man has no legs. Right? So everything has to be at ground level for him. So you can imagine if he goes into a modern apartment block, it is totally useless to him. Any property there is totally useless to him. And I discussed with both of these people the notion that they might put themselves on the housing list, and they said, why? We've good jobs. We're able to pay the rent. We don't need to look to the state to provide accommodation for us. But what they do need is they need supports. And I think you and I discussed this during the discussions on the programme for government, that we would have some recognition of rent paid in lieu of deposit requirements when it comes to purchasing property. These people are paying somewhere between 1400 and 1600 euros per month for their apartments. So you can understand they're middle of the road employees, so they're never going to be able to save money. That's the hard fact on it. The notion brought forward by my colleague there a few moments ago on the issue of VAT and the reduction of VAT may greatly assist them in purchasing a house. And I don't want to throw another spanner in the works for you, Minister, because you have enough on your plate. But we have to find some way of supporting people like this that want to remain independent, that are independent living. All they ask for is that where they will be allowed to live will be central enough to allow them to work. A battery operator's wheelchair will only go so far before it needs to be recharged. In all cases, these people need two wheelchairs, one which is a push wheelchair, the other one is a battery operated one, depending on what they're doing or where they're going at any given time. Both of the people I'm talking about go on holidays internationally. Now, some people might say I'm talking about the money side of their lives. They're entitled to their holiday like anybody else. But we have to find a way of enabling them to have the same opportunity to build a home as you or I, who are able bodies. Because when I met one of these individuals the first time I met him, when I saw him coming towards me, I said, oh my God, what am I going to say, right? Because it wasn't what I expected. And 10 minutes after I met him, I forgot he was in a wheelchair, disabled. And anybody that has ever met this guy would have exactly the same experience. So I'm asking you, when you come forward with your plan, to perhaps think about the VAT option. Perhaps look at some way that we can maybe instruct builders to provide one apartment in a block of, or in every 60 they build, that would meet the needs of a specific set of disabilities. And if we could do that, I think we might make these people's lives an awful lot better. We're going to have to do something, and I know it's not your remit, we're going to have to do something with the way the banks require deposits before they lend money. We're going to have to do something on that for these young people. I know that's something that affects all young people, but these people have a specific need. So I just ask you to take that on board. I really wish you well with your portfolio. I really am impressed the way you've come out fighting, as it were, and I hope it really goes well for you. Thank you very much, indeed, Minister.
There's three other speakers offering, but it's the Minister's prerogative. He wants to come in whenever, so it's...
I have no problem waiting. My only complication is that I have water legislation in the Dáil just before 6:30.
Well, Minister, you have...
So I'd like to be able to make a contribution.
Yes, I'll give you 15 minutes now.
At some point,
the others,
but it's, yeah. I'm in your hands. I'll happily wait.
No, you have the right away, sir. Minister.
Is that okay with... first of all, can I just say that I think this is a really useful debate. It's the first thing. There's a lot of knowledge in this room, clearly, about this area. So I want to thank Senator Dolan and Senator Sullivan. I know Senator Keller actually quite well, and given her experience with the various organisations she's worked for, I think it's a really good example of the Senate adding value to a debate around a sectoral area that obviously needs a comprehensive policy response. Obviously having ex-ministers here for housing significantly helps that as well. Can I just say that we do have a housing strategy that will be launched next Tuesday afternoon, I hope, as long as I get it approved by government on Tuesday. It's not going to perform miracles or deal comprehensively with everything, but I think it'll be a good start to a response towards a whole series of pressures that are linked to housing and a shortage of supply, as well as a response to the systems that aren't delivering at a pace that they need to deliver, whether that's housing for people with a disability or the myriad of other areas that the state needs to respond to linked to housing at a faster pace than we've been able to do it to date. And obviously there are resource issues which need to be resolved and finalised before that programme can be launched. But just to say, I hope we'll have an opportunity to maybe have statements in this House next week after that. Certainly, I'd like to come in and talk through some of the sectors and get some feedback. And I will be the first to say that strategy isn't the finished article. We'll add to it as needed. This will be a moving strategy effectively for the next 2 years or for the lifetime of the government, however long that lasts. And we'll add and subtract and amend and change and improve as we go along when people make good suggestions. So there's been quite a lot of stakeholder consultation already, including some with the disability sector. And we'll try and take on board as much as we can. But just to flag that, and as I say, I'll be happy to come in and talk next week, if we can do that, if the schedule permits, obviously, so that actually people can see the detail of it and comment and add to that. Addressing the need of people with disabilities is already well established in housing policy, and I think it's important to say that. Certainly, when with the publication of the National Housing Strategy for People with Disabilities and the related implementation framework 2011 and 2012 was certainly a significant step in the right direction. These documents have guided policy considerations and delivery of housing for people with disabilities since then. The commitment in the programme for partnership government to ensure that the needs of people with disabilities are incorporated into all future housing policies reflects the priority that the government does attach to this issue. We will consolidate and build on the significant work to date and ensure that momentum is enhanced and sustained into the future. And that commitment will be further reinforced with the action plan that I referred to that we're launching next week. The National Housing Strategy for People with a Disability was a turning point in how the housing needs of people with disabilities would be addressed. The strategy and implementation framework, which are published jointly by my department and the Department of Health, were developed as part of a coherent and integrated framework for the delivery of housing for people with disabilities. The strategy sets out the broad framework aimed at promoting and mainstreaming equality of access for people with a disability to a full range of housing options available, suited to individual and household need, and to support them in living independently in their own homes. The strategy's approach is twofold. It supports people with disabilities who are already living in the community and who may require more specific supports to enable them to remain in their own home or move to a more suitable accommodation as their needs change. Secondly, the strategy gives effect to the housing provisions outlined in the government's mental health policy, A Vision for Change, and the report of the Working Group on Congregated Settings, which a number of people in their contributions today have already referred to. Both policies provide for the transitioning of people with disabilities from institutional care to more appropriate community-based living arrangements. And I think perhaps the kind of discussions that are the comments that were made earlier in terms of benchmarking how we're doing versus other European countries in this regard would be no harm at all in terms of some of the challenges that we're facing, particularly the contribution from Senator McFadden in relation to that issue. Implementation of identified actions in the National Housing Strategy for People with Disabilities is being driven primarily by the Housing Agency by means of a dedicated subgroup. The subgroup has representatives from my department, the Department of Health, the Health Service Executive, local authorities, the Irish Council for Social Housing, and various disability representative organisations. Since it was established in 2012, the subgroup has overseen and progressed a range of priority actions, including the development of national guidelines for the assessment of allocation process for housing provision for people with disabilities. Secondly, the establishment of a housing and disability steering groups within local authorities, which were welcomed earlier, and the preparation of draft strategic plans for local areas to help identify and address the housing needs of people with a disability over the next 5 years. The local plans are currently being collated by the National Housing Agency into a draft national strategic plan and will be submitted to my department very shortly. Progress in implementing the strategy is being overseen by an implementation monitoring group, which is chaired by my department and includes representatives again from the Department of Health and the HSE, the Housing Agency, the National Disability Authority, the Irish Council for Social Housing, the County and City Management Association and disability representative bodies. So what we have here is a strategy, a plan to make it work, and we essentially have an implementation monitoring group to make sure that it actually happens. The implementation of the strategy is an excellent example of the collaborative work, working arrangements between my department, the Department of Health, HSE, and relevant stakeholders in recent years. Key to this approach is the inclusion and contribution of representatives from the disability sector and others, and I'd like to take this opportunity to thank everybody who's involved. This partnership approach involving cross-departmental and interagency cooperation recognises that the provision of suitable housing is only one element in supporting people with disabilities to live fully inclusive lives. The programme for government commits to preparing the publication of an action plan for housing within the government's first 100 days. The action plan is being drafted and is near finalisation, with input from a number of key government departments. It would also draw on the framework of the Special Oireachtas Committee, on the work of the Special Oireachtas Committee on Housing and Homelessness and the recommendations that they have included. The action plan will be delivery focused and will build on the considerable work already carried out or underway. It will include actions to boost supply of all types of housing in the immediate, medium and longer terms. The plan will have a particular focus on having on those having most difficulty in accessing the housing and rental markets at the moment, and will include the needs of specific groups, and of course will include a section on people with disabilities. In this regard, the action plan will affirm and underpin support for the continuation of the National Housing Strategy for people with disabilities beyond 2016. My department, through the Capital Assistance Scheme, provides important funding for approved housing bodies to provide funding for priority groups, including people with disabilities. In July 2015, under CAS, a total funding of €151 million was allocated to deliver 1,057 new accommodation units through construction and acquisition, and former Minister Coveney would have been very involved in that. This investment shows a strong commitment to meeting special housing needs for those who may require particular supports, including people with disabilities. It is my intention to continue to provide funding for an ambitious construction and an acquisitions programme under the Capital Assistance Scheme into the future. Implementation of the HSC Congregated Settings Report is supported by my department, which is represented on the HSE-led working group. In order to accelerate progress in transitioning individuals from congregated settings, my department is providing ring-fenced funding of €10 million in 2016 under CAS. This is specifically for the provision of housing for people with disabilities who are moving out of congregated settings into community-based living arrangements. Separate to this, CAS funding is also available to provide housing for people with disabilities in the community more generally. The Capital Assistance Scheme draws on the knowledge and capacity of the approved housing body sector to provide high-quality housing suitable for people with a disability, and it will continue to be well-funded as part of the Government's new action plan for housing to deliver for those that need social housing provision. My department also provides funding to local authorities under the housing adaptation grants for older people and people with a disability in relation to private homes, and separately funds adaptations and extensions to social housing stock to meet the needs of tenants with a disability. But I do take on board what people have said in relation to those two schemes. Total funding under the adaptations grants scheme has been increased in 2016 by 10% to an overall funding availability of just over €56 million. 7,600 households benefited under this scheme in 2015, and with the additional funding provided, it's expected that this will increase to about 8,000 homes this year, 2016. I am conscious of the significant social benefit accruing from this scheme in terms of facilitating the continued independent living by people with a disability in their own homes. Therefore, in line with the programme for government, I will be giving further consideration to increasing this funding over the coming years. I also understand how important it is that that grant schemes such as these can be readily accessed by those who need them. My department will continue to work with local authorities to review the delivery of the schemes and streamline the application processes. I'm satisfied that the current regulatory framework for the assessment and allocation of households in need of social housing support, coupled with the guidance issued, provides the necessary provision to ensure that the particular needs of households who has someone with a disability are effectively assessed and prioritised quickly and appropriately. The allocation of social housing supports to all qualified households is a matter for individual housing authorities in accordance with their allocation schemes. A housing authority may prioritise certain classes of households for allocation on the basis of severity of need as they see fit. And households who have a person with a disability may be given a priority ranking. The results of the 2016 Summary of Social Housing Assessments will, when available later this year, provide updated data on the numbers on housing waiting lists, including current information on the level of households with disabilities in need of social housing supports. But I take it from the motion that you've put down today that number is still significant. I think it's in somewhere between 3,500 to 4,000. In preparation, or in preparing its housing strategy under the Planning and Development Act 2000, each planning authority must have regard to the most recent a summary of social housing assessments, and also the need to ensure that a mixture of housing types and sizes is developed to reasonably match the requirements of different categories of households. This includes the special requirements of elderly persons and persons with a disability. They must also have regard to relevant policies or objectives of the government, including the National Housing Strategy for People with Disability. It is a matter, therefore, for a planning authority in making a Part 5 agreement to ensure that the units provided in any given development will satisfy its housing need. A decision on whether a certain percentage of Part 5 units should be reserved for people with a disability is a matter for individual local authorities in accordance with its own strategy. But can I just reinforce what a number of people said earlier? There will be no going back to developers being able to buy their way out of Part 5 obligations. That is not going to happen. And we are going to create an acceptance and an understanding and hopefully a non-issue around a certain percentage of every new housing estate that's being built being allocated for social housing, or affordable housing, or special needs housing, or whatever it is. And if we can't manage that as a society, well, then the comments that Eoin Reardon mentioned earlier, you know, I think ring very true. So we need to create an understanding and an acceptance, and we also need to create a reality that when you drive into a housing estate, you don't notice the difference between social housing and private housing. It's just an estate that is diverse, with a mix of different family types and sizes and challenges and all the other things that people face in their lives. And I am determined to do that in the context of our housing strategy, that we do not build acres and acres of social housing to try and meet a need and facilitate the building of acres and acres of private housing in some other part of the city where the two communities aren't integrating and meeting, and the kind of stigma that gets built up around that needs to be addressed head on. Finally, can I just say, in relation to the ratification of the UN Convention on the Rights of Persons with a Disability, we are committed to doing that. It is in the programme for government, and we're trying to make that happen as soon as we can. Can I just finally say that Fine Gael, as former Minister Coveney has pointed out, will be supporting this motion. I think it's a good motion. I think it's very timely as well in the context of the of our own government response to housing need next week. And I look forward to coming back into this House to actually work through the detail, not only in relation to the disability elements of that housing strategy, but the broader strategy itself. And I thank all of the senators actually for their comments. I think it's been very constructive. I know we're not discussing bins today, I think the nature of this debate, as I say, has been very constructive and helpful, and I'll try and take on board as much of it as I can.
Thank you, Minister. Senator Keller.
Points that I was making have been made eloquently, and it's great to see such consensus, particularly around the area of congregated settings. What I would say to you, Minister Coveney, and I've known you for a long, long time, the congregated settings issue is a bricks and mortar issue, it's a money issue, but above all, it's a moral issue. And people are living lives of quiet desperation because they've no choices. And really, when we're thinking about all of this and we are making plans and all of this, we need to think about the lives of people caught up in a system where they have no basic choices that we would consider ordinary to most of the rest of us. I met a man who had to battle the system in an organisation that I worked in to leave a congregated setting. And there was every kind of obstacle and blockage put in his way. I met him coming out of Tiger buying mugs for his new flat. Now, that was one person, but it needs to be many more of those people. And I'm delighted to support the motion. And I'm delighted that you have taken it on board. And I know you of old. And I hope that when you are looking at those strategies and plans and all those intergroups that we've all sat on, that we keep mindful of the person at the end of that and the people that are at the end of that, and make sure that we are monitoring properly so that all of these plans and numbers that we talk about are actually getting through to those individuals. That's all I want to say.
Thank you. Very brief, Senator. Thank you. Thank you, Minister. Next we have Senator Conway.
It's a pity the Minister is to go, but he's ably represented, so he's, you're very welcome. I'd like to join with others in commending John Dolan, Senator Dolan, for tabling what is a very opportune and appropriate and detailed private member's motion. Of course, it's John Dolan is no stranger to advocacy work. He's been involved in the disability movement for many, many years through his CEO, his role as CEO of the Disability Federation of Ireland. And I'd like to acknowledge the representatives of the DFI who are here around the House today and other organisations, in particular Elaine Howley, the new Head of Advocacy in the National Council of the Blind of Ireland. I'd like to welcome her and wish her well in her new role. It is true to say that disability and people with disabilities have been very adversely affected over the last number of years as a result of the recession, and also as a result of decisions made by the last government and the government previous to that in terms of the cuts that were imposed on people with disabilities, whether it's respite care or whether it's cuts in terms of the adaptation grants and the adaptation grants given to councillors to facilitate people, particularly older people, who acquire a disability later in life to be able to remain in their own homes. You know, those measures could have been avoided and should have been avoided and weren't avoided because you know, governments made choices and they could easily have made alternative choices. You know, I firmly believe and do have for some time that the next budget, and indeed a number of future budgets, should not have any tax cuts, because we don't need tax cuts. What we need is investment in public services. What we need is investment in housing. What we need is investment to bring our health services, our housing stock, you know, to bring these up to a standard that would even be considered fit for purpose at an international level. I firmly believe that we have a housing crisis. I do believe that the government is committed to resolving that. I believe that we are in a situation where we're going to have a plan published, I believe, next week that is going to comprehensively deal as a starting measure with the housing crisis. And I am comforted in the words of the Minister in his contribution here this evening, where he did say that you know, people with disabilities are going to be a fundamental, integral part of this plan. I welcome, you know, the various strategies that many people in this House have been involved in, and I know Senator Kelleher and the work she has done, particularly in Cork, and the strategies that she has set in. I think it is appropriate that we should have local strategies, because what is appropriate to resolve the problems in Limerick City may not necessarily be appropriate in terms of solving the problems in Mayo or Clare or other areas. So you have to have localised strategies to try and identify how best the public purse can be spent to have the maximum effect in ensuring that people have independent living and the people who have the wherewithal and the desire and the ability to live in their own homes can do so, and that these homes should be modified appropriately to accommodate their needs. We are coming from behind with this, but like, we have to be positive going forward. Seanad Éireann has a significant role to play in reminding government of its duties to all citizens of this country. I think that this motion certainly does that, and I'm glad that the government have decided to support this motion, because it is the right thing to do. This House has a tradition of coming together when something is the right thing to do, and I note our motions in the last Senate on issues, very important issues like direct provision and other areas that were important to the citizens of this country. I'm glad that we are coming together to support this motion to send a clear message to government, you know, that this is an issue that Seanad Éireann cares about, that Seanad Éireann will come together in supporting, and that the message is unambiguous and clear. And I am hopeful that with the confidence and supply agreement that is in place, that with the support of Fianna Fáil and independents and so forth, that the government will have the necessary resources, will have the necessary confidence, and will have the necessary competence to make a significant dent in what is a very, very difficult and challenging situation. I believe that if in 5 years' time, were the government ever to run 5 years, which is most unlikely, but if it were, that we could come back here and say with the collective efforts and energy of us all, government delivering and public representatives and senators like us advocating and reminding that we actually may have a success and that we may see the numbers dropping. The ideal world is that anybody with a disability who wishes to live at home and wishes to live within the communities would be facilitated. That is an ideal world. Maybe sometime we may get to it. But until then, we need to ensure that the journey towards that goal is accelerated and that every measure is taken to ensure that more and more people benefit from that ultimate desire that we all have. There's a lot being said today, a lot of good ideas. I think Senator Crockwell's suggestion on VAT is absolutely worthy of consideration. We have to think outside the box in resolving these issues. I know that the Minister did point out that the housing strategy that will be published next week is a fluid document and will be considered a work in progress. And that's only right and proper that it should. And if more resources become available, well then it should be that such resources should be put in, and extra resources should be put in to resolving these problems. And you know, where there is logical localised solutions, and as I said, what might exist in Cork may not work in Mayo, and what works in Mayo may not work in Carlow. But so where there are localised solutions, where various organisations work together, various NGOs work together, well, those solutions need to be explored and actioned. So with that, I'd like to wish the Minister well. I am encouraged by his words, but I have to say for Senator Dolan's first motion, it is timely, it's appropriate, and I think it will have the desired effect.
Thank you. Senator Hopkins.
Similarly, I would like to thank Senator John Nolan, Senator Grace O'Sullivan and the other independent senators who have brought this private member's motion forward today. I certainly welcome the opportunity to speak on this motion as a healthcare professional. Having worked as an occupational therapist over the past 8 years, I've worked with many people who have suffered from disability. And I suppose I've been involved with a lot of people in terms of housing adaptations. So I bring that experience. And I suppose I'm also quite mindful of what the Minister has said here today in terms of the wealth of experience within the Seanad with regard to this issue. We as legislators must work to ensure that our country provides appropriate and adequate housing for those with disabilities. No individual in this state should be disadvantaged in their access to accommodation because they suffer from a disability. And I think the figures that have been presented in the context of this motion are very stark. We're working on 2013 figures where it shows that almost 4,000 people have a disability who are on the housing list. And we must make sure that these applications are progressed as quickly as possible. I suppose we all await the action plan on housing, which is to be announced next week. And I think it's important that time was taken to look at that, because it's very much cross-departmental. And it's the same for people with the disability. It crosses so many different departments, from health to social protection to jobs and enterprise to children. And also to make sure that people with disabilities are very much involved in that process too. And I certainly welcome Minister Coveney's contribution earlier in terms of the action plan on housing being a working document per se, in terms of, I suppose, looking at what changes are positive or what changes need to be amended. I want to focus on two specific issues. They have been raised already. I want to particularly focus on the provision of housing adaptation grants and the barriers, really, in terms of the challenges for people with disability. The grants provide older people and people with a disability with an opportunity to continue independent living in their own homes for as long as possible. And we have seen an increase in the funding for 2016, which is a really important a positive step. In my own county of Roscommon, the allocation for this year was 945,000, up from 811,000 in 2015. And these grants, as has been stated already, are absolutely vital for people with a disability in order to support modifications required within their home. I would make two points in relation to it. One is that it's really important that these grants are processed as efficiently as possible. Certainly, I have worked with many individuals, many families, who have to stay unnecessary time within hospital or within convalescence because of a delay in terms of processing of applications. Certainly, we know it's down to the local authorities in terms of processing those applications, but it's really important that the government take an active role in terms of making sure the targets are met with regard to it. I would also ask the Minister that the threshold for household income be reviewed. Currently, it's based on the property owner's annual gross income together with their spouse or partner's annual gross income in the previous tax year. So combined earnings of over 60,000 means that an individual is ineligible. Certainly, having worked as an OT within the health service, I definitely know of many families who have had to pay the entire cost of modifications as they're slightly over the threshold. And at that, financially, it is exceptionally difficult for them to pay all of the costs of renovation. And oftentimes, they end up having to pay private care, home support costs as well. So I would really ask that the threshold be reviewed to assist as many people as possible who have a disability. It's difficult enough, but financial stress as well can be added if they don't meet that threshold. My second point really is with regard to the motion makes specific reference to the significant numbers of people with disabilities who are living in nursing homes or similar facilities. Many of these people are really young and they could be much more appropriately accommodated in a hospital setting. And I say this, I actually find it very upsetting, and have done in my previous job, to see young people who have real potential being discharged to a long-term care facility. It's inappropriate. It shouldn't happen. These people deserve better. We need to look towards supporting the best quality of life for them. Long-term care in a facility surrounded by older people is not the right place to support them and to ensure that their potential is reached. And I would really ask, I know, I suppose there has been moves in terms of moving towards more community care and away from institutional settings, but I really believe there needs to be a stronger focus on this. It is not right that young, particularly young people who have so much potential And I suppose in many cases it's very difficult to for them to be accommodated in their own homes. But there needs to be, I suppose, a middle ground to support them as much as possible within an appropriate community setting. Finally, I would just like to say that I very much look forward to working with Minister Coveney, Minister English, and the senators here who have a real passion and a real commitment towards supporting people with disabilities. And I think today was a really important debate in, you know, earmarking that, you know, people with disabilities need support, they need a voice, and that we here are going to do what we can to help them. And I think, you know, while the debate here is on housing, it's much more than that, and it crosses so many departments, and that needs to be incorporated into the action plan for housing, which will be launched next week. So, thank you.
Senator Dolan, you have 5 minutes to conclude.
Very difficult for me to honour the contributions and the thoughtfulness and passion and interest that members right across the House have showed for the last 2 hours. So maybe just to note that. In relation to the Minister, he again acknowledged the good knowledge that is in the Senate in relation to this, and that is primarily across many of the senators that have participated at local authority level themselves and from their own experience. In relation to the launch next Tuesday, the Minister has talked about it being a good start. I am coming back again to what I said earlier on. Things really have to happen over the next 2 to 3 years. We have the demographic going against us. Now, it's good news in the sense that there are a lot of people living longer. Senator Hopkins, we've talked about people with stroke that would have died 10, 15 years ago and now living, but they live with the legacy of it. They need supports. We don't know who's the person tomorrow or the following week, but we know there are people. So we need actually to outflank this issue, not alone just catch up. We actually as a society have to outflank the problem and get ahead of it. That is a stretch for us, but it can be done, and it is for the betterment of society as a whole. The Minister in his remarks did say that the government does attach priority to this issue, and that commitment will be further reinforced next week. We look forward to that. I think you have here today, you have senators that have shown great, after the earlier second stage motion in relation to reform of the Seanad and people with knowledge and experience, I think there was a lovely example in this motion of people bringing that to this debate. I needn't have put so much energy into my original piece, because people just took it and went with it. And there was a great flow of information, ideas and commitment. So I think the Minister has said he offered that he will come back and take statements and whatever. So that is really, really positive. And I think you have the Minister, the Department engaged. If this afternoon is anything to go by, is not alone engaged, but is able to bring something to the table. And there are a lot of organisations here and otherwise interested in this debate. So we have a triumvirate interest to try and find practical ways now to coalesce. There are tensions. Senator Adonna Reardon mentioned some of them, in relation to members of local authorities putting their money where their mouth is or whatever. There are tensions about local communities wanting to say that's very fine but not here. Senator Martin Conway talked about, look, it's not tax cuts we need, we need public services. And these services are not just for disabled people. Without doing an exclusive or an in-depth piece of research, I can tell this House there's going to be at least 50,000 people between now and this day next year who will have a disability that don't have one today, of one kind or another. Now, they're not all going to be needing housing support, but there isn't the disabled. There are people who will become disabled. So we have to plan for that contingency, and that's clearly what this is about. So I was very pleased as well to hear the Minister in his conclusion underline again what Minister McGrath had done here 2 weeks ago, that the commitment of the government to ratification of the UN Convention, and many people, I didn't particularly mention it, other people did mention it, Article 19. Cathaoirleach, I'm happy to leave it at that, to thank everybody, and we look forward to taking this up and working also with the officials in the department, and indeed, as has been said, many other people. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Senator Dolan. Is the motion agreed to? Agreed. When is it proposed to sit again?
Madnamarach, 10:30.
The House stands adjourned till Madnamarach and Lahore Thresh Day.